the Facebook deal where we just merged? Or is it, it's not merged, if we...
Ready?
Okay.
Yep. Sorry.
Well, good morning.
Morning.
Welcome to Calvary Shop in Franklin. Glad you could make it out this morning. Feels like we're in Chicago, I know, but I'm glad you're here, so praise the Lord. Hey, does anybody need a bulletin or a Bible? We'd like to make sure we get one in your hands, and just raise your hand if you need one. All right, well, very good. Well, I'll tell you what, before we begin, let me share a few announcements that are going on. I guess let me share a couple of things in particular about Michael and Julie. I know we've been praying for them. They're in Ukraine. They're on their way home right now, actually. Or they'll be leaving this afternoon. I forget, but they'll be coming home, I think, this evening or something. So, but they've had a very good visit with Angela and also Brian and Krista, who are adopting Valya, who some of you met when Julie and I were hosting her for a couple of weeks. And they're adopting Valya. And so they've been together over there for a good part of their trip on this this journey and also. But keep them in prayer. There was an issue where they were afraid of a TB test coming back negative. It sounds like that may be okay, but they're waiting for one more, I think, doctor to sign off on it. That apparently would push the adoption way back if she needed to get over that. So we're very thankful that that this seems to be working out okay. But just keep them in prayer. There's a little bit of time left before the adoption is finalized. They've got two more trips, one in several weeks, and then another several weeks after that, we'll bring her home. So please keep her in prayer, them in prayer, I should say. And then also, Bob and Susan Kraft, as you know, they have moved to Arizona. They've gone west, and I know some of you follow them on Facebook. For any of you who aren't aware, when they got there, it turned out the realtor had misplaced some vital piece of paperwork that was necessary for closing. So they were not able to move in when they got there like they had expected. So it turns out somebody they know there has provided like a guest house for them to stay in for the time being. I didn't check this morning, but I don't know if they've gotten that straightened out yet or not. So keep them in prayer. It's just a hiccup, but you know, I'm not sure they'd like to just settle in and be done with get moved in. So anyway, Bob and Susan Kraft, you want to pray for them if you would as well. A couple things going on around here we want to share. Of course, our youth group meets at 9 o'clock on Sunday morning, so you can see Justin and Tara Oslett about that. Our Tuesday morning men's breakfast and Bible. We're going through the book of James. And that's on Tuesdays at 9 o'clock at our house, actually. And we cook breakfast for the guys. So, you know, if you need another good reason to come out, you know, the best way to a man's heart is through his stomach. And I believe that can be spiritually true, too. So we'll give you some breakfast, and then we'll open our Bibles together, and we'll get into that. So speaking of men's studies, in conjunction with the women's study is also meeting on Tuesday evenings. And that's at Stacy and Ryan Martinez's house in West Haven. That will continue for about another 4 weeks or so, and then they'll be finished. And then we'll take maybe a couple of weeks in between, and then we're going to begin an evening men's study. And we're going to, actually, Charlie brought this idea up some time ago. They used to do this at his old church, and we're finally going to get around to starting it here. It's basically an in-depth study of a book of the Bible where you're not just hearing me teach on it for a period of time, but we're all actually digging in, pulling out a concordance. We're finding out the Greek. You know, in other words, you're getting your Bible on, you're getting your Greek and your Hebrew on. And we're learning how to learn, as a matter of fact. You know, we do believe very much here in teaching the Word of God verse by verse, and this kind of adds a dimension on not just teaching the Word, but learning how to learn the Word yourself as well. So it's like the old adage, you know, if you give a man a fish, he eats for a day. Teach a man a fish, he eats for a lifetime. So that's the motivation behind that. And now we'll continue on. We'll go through a book of the Bible that way, and then once we finish that, the ladies can then start up another study. We'll kind of rotate back and forth, giving God a chance to come out in the evening. We will continue our men's breakfast and Bible during that time. We took a survey, and the guys want to continue on it, and I do too. So we're going to do both on Tuesdays when that time comes around. But for now, the women still have their study going on, and then Elizabeth George's book, Walking in God's Promises, that will be for about another 4 weeks or so. And then, of course, Thursday mornings, Madeline hosts the women's prayer at 10 o'clock at her house. That's here in Franklin. Ladies, if you'd like to join that group at 10 o'clock on Thursday mornings, you can see Madeline about that, and she'll be glad to give you more insight as far as how to get there and that kind of thing. And then Thursday evenings, we have our midweek study, and that's at Charlie and Lonnie Penner's house as well. We're going through the book of Exodus on Thursday nights, and that's a great time, so we invite you to come out. By the way, if you're not able to make it on Thursday nights, we do broadcast that live, stream it live over the internet. You can go to our website, and there's a section on the homepage that speaks about how these Sunday mornings and Thursday nights, video and audio are available to watch or listen to by stream. So I encourage you to check that out as well. We're trying to venture out into that and kind of nail that down a little bit. And it's an opportunity for you to still be connected, even if you can't physically make it out. So, although we'd love to have you, but that's a great resource otherwise. And then, guys, we're going to have a men's fellowship dinner. We're going to schedule that actually in February, the 21st, at 6 o'clock. So, guys, if you'd like to come out for a meal and some great fellowship, the men and women try to get together every so often and just have a time just to get together over a meal and just enjoy some time together. We have typically done that at O'Charlie's on 96, but we're open for suggestions. So if you guys are coming and you got some ideas, we're not married to O'Charlie's. We can go anywhere. So, all right, enough with the announcements. You can, of course, read those things in your bulletin as well. But as we begin our worship service this morning, I'd invite you to stand with me as we read Psalm 20 together. And we actually have it. We can put it up this week. There we go. Well, why don't you all stand with us and we'll read it together. There it is. I got to break it up maybe a little bit. But hey, we're making progress, though. So, okay, now we don't have to worry about all the different versions, translations, and all that kind of thing. But it is from the New King James, but you're welcome to read your Bible or read right from the screen, Psalm 20. But let's read it out loud together as we come before the Lord. Psalm 20. David says, starting in verse 1, "May the Lord answer you in the day of trouble. May the name of the God of Jacob defend you. And may he send you help from the sanctuary and strengthen you out of Zion. May he remember all your offerings and accept your burnt sacrifice. May he grant you according to your heart's desire and fulfill your purpose. We will rejoice in your salvation and in the name of our God. We will set up our banners. May the Lord fulfill all your petitions. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He will answer him from his holy heaven with the same strength of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. They have bowed down and fallen, but we have risen and stand upright. Save, Lord. May the King answer us when we call." Father, we thank you for your glorious word. We thank you for your glorious presence here among us. We thank you that you desire to meet with your people. And when we gather and worship, it's a sweet time where your name is exalted, where we put our hearts and our minds and focus on you. We lift our voices, even our hands. Lord, as we stand before you, we desire to honor you and give you the glory that's due your holy name. You alone are great, and you alone are worthy of praise. You've shown yourself strong on our behalf many times, more than we can count. And we want to respond to that. You've provided for us. You've guided us. You've led us. You have changed our eternal destiny because of the work that your Son accomplished at the cross. Father, apart from you, we are nothing. We can not only not do anything, but we are nothing. We need you, Lord. We honor you, we bless you, we worship you, we humble ourselves before you as we lift our voices, singing of your great name and of your goodness. We pray that our hearts would be open to you this morning, that, Lord, we wouldn't withhold our desire, our worship from you, Father. We wouldn't think it a strange thing to lift our voices, but, Father, rather we would just sing openly to an audience of one. And Father, nothing would distract us. And then, Father, we wouldn't feel content to leave our troubles outside, but rather to bring them here to this place, to the foot of the cross, and to leave them there, knowing that you, Father, are sufficient for all of our needs. We thank you, we praise you, and we bless you. Be glorified as we sing this morning, and exalt your name. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Praise the Lord, lift our voices and enjoy the voice of the Lord. Yeah.
Shout to Mary God Almighty,
your holiness, Lord, for being worthy of our praise, Lord. And Lord, as we look at your holiness, Lord, and we realize how unholy we are, Lord, and for that we are just so grateful for your blood that covers that, Lord. And so we come before you this morning, Lord, and we just pray that you would just help us to let your holiness cover our unholiness, Lord, that we would surrender all of the things that we might be holding on to, Lord, the things that are keeping us from a full and deep relationship with you every day, Lord. We just sing this song, this next song, as a prayer to you, Lord, that you would change us, Lord, change our hearts, change our lives, make us more like you.
Giving you my heart and all that it is within, I lay it all down for the sake of you, my King. I'm giving you my dreams, I'm laying down my heart, I'm giving up my pride for the promise of you. Giving you my heart and all that is within, I lay it all down for the sake of you, my King. Giving you my dreams, laying down my heart, giving up I'm
Sunday with us. Again, if you need a Bible, we're going to open them this morning and be going through the what remains of 1 Timothy. Just raise your hand if you need a Bible. It looks like everybody's ready to roll. Some of you got Bibles, some of you got switchblades, some of you got iPods. And praise the Lord. I guess I'm going to have to get used to the joy of hearing pages turn is one thing. I'm going to have to get used to the sound of the swish of your fingers moving your home screens back and forth. So, but praise the Lord. We have been going through the New Testament. We find ourselves in 1 Timothy. And this morning we're going to finish the last handful of verses from 12 through 21. And as we finish this letter. Now, if you've not been with us along the way, just a slight bit of backing up here just to give some context. Timothy is the pastor of the church at Ephesus. And Paul has put him in place there. And Timothy has not had the easiest time in ministry. He is a younger man. Doesn't mean he was a kid necessarily. Estimates are anywhere between, 15, 18, all the way up to 30-ish or something like that. But he was not an older man. And because of that, he kind of took some flack from some of the folks that had been in that fellowship or body of churches in the city. They had given him kind of a hard time to the point where Paul actually had to encourage him and say, don't let anyone despise you because of your youth. The charges that Paul gives Timothy are many in this short letter, and we'll continue on in 2 Timothy as well. But they're weighty, they're substantial, they're the kinds of things that require him to go ahead and stand up and recognize that he has a calling upon his life, and that calling is enough to carry him regardless of the kinds of opposition he might face from those who maybe think less of him than is right. Of course, we never want to think more highly of ourselves than we ought, but we don't get the sense that that was a problem for Timothy. And so Paul is reassuring him and fortifying him throughout this letter, helping him to realize that, look, you have been anointed by God. You've been called. You've recognized that God had empowered you for the ministry he's called you to. We'll see other echoes of this in 2 Timothy as well, where he again reassures him of this so he would recognize that it's you don't do God a service by slouching away from that which he's called you to do. No one should ever stand in a pulpit and feel like they deserve to be there, but equally so, no pastor should ever stand in a pulpit and apologize for the calling on his life. He should simply stand his post and discharge the duty that God has called him to. We rely entirely on the strength of God and the guidance of the Holy Spirit to accomplish anything, and as soon as we forget that, of course Jesus said in John 15, you can, apart from you can accomplish nothing. And as soon as we forget that, we'll make sure we remember it the hard way. And so we want to make sure we just faithfully go about it. But of course, Timothy, I don't think, had any issues recognizing that, that he felt inadequate about it. And of course, others may have reminded him of that, but I don't think that was an issue for him. It's kind of like the opposite of this would be the pastor and the Bible teacher, the student that came out of seminary, ready to give his first sermon. And it was in a very prestigious church with a grand pulpit and elders sitting on chairs behind, and he had his suit on, he was ready to go, he had his notes neatly in order, he was ready to give his message, he was studied, he was learned, he had a degree, he had many letters after his name, MDivs and the like, and he walks up to the pulpit and he sets his notes down and he opens his Bible, and as he is prepared to deliver this fantastically prepared message that he had, a door opens on the side of the sanctuary and blows his notes all off the podium. And he begins to scramble to get them all back together. And finally, he shuffles them and gets them all back together. But now he's all disheveled. And he manages through his message. And then he walks down off the podium completely discouraged, even despondent. And a wise old elder in the church leans to another and says, if he had walked up like he went down, he might have gone down like he went up. Okay, we need to rely on the Lord and recognize our calling and such is entirely a gift from him. And our service to him, if not empowered by him, will not go very far. Lest the Lord builds the house, who labors truly labor in vain. Well, Paul is encouraging Timothy to recognize his calling and to live it out, to stand up and to do that, to minister that ministry he has. Now, as we begin this last section here, I want to go ahead and read verses 12 through, 12 through 16 to start off with, but we will finish the letter this morning. But let's turn to chapter 6, verse 12. I'm going to go ahead and read starting in that verse. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I urge you in the sight of God who gives life to all things and before Christ Jesus who witnessed the good confession before Pontius Pilate that you keep this commandment without spot blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ's appearing, which he will manifest in his own time. He who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality dwelling in an approachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, and to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. Now it's been said that the Christian life is not a playground, it's a battleground. It's a place where spiritual warfare must be waged, because if you don't wage it, the enemy will, and you don't want to be left sitting when you should be standing and fighting, lest you be run over. Now, Timothy learned that this is, in fact, a truth that lies at the heart of pastoral ministry. I should point out that though we should and will and hopefully will continue to glean from this letter, we should remember that this letter was not written to the church at Ephesus. It was written to its pastor. It was written with a person in mind who was called to lead that group of believers. And so Paul speaks, as you've noticed, very directly. But he doesn't speak to the church at large, but he speaks to Timothy about what the church should be like, what his role in it should be, and the kinds of things that should be expected of a body of believers. And we've covered these things as we've come to this point. And again, that said, we want to be wise to glean from what the Holy Spirit would say through these words, but we should remember that ultimately the primary target of these things was a young pastor, and Paul's intention was to bring him instruction, encouragement, and even warning. And here in these last, a few verses of this book, we don't see this lacking in any way. He continues on a very strong note as he brings the end to his letter. Now, repeatedly, Paul has charged Timothy throughout this letter, and we'll see it again in 2 Timothy as well. He's charged him to preach the word, to take heed to the doctrine, and thereby protect himself and others who would be led astray otherwise by false teaching, to stand up to those who would teach other kinds of doctrines. And again, as our passage opened this morning, to fight the good fight of faith. The word fight there literally means to struggle with or to wrestle with to the point of exhaustion, to press on, to not take this battle lightly, but to pour everything you have into it. It's where we get our word agonize from. This idea here of giving your all to obtain a goal, a victory, or a prize. It's the kind of word that would be used of an athlete. As a matter of fact, Paul uses athletic terms throughout his epistles. He's no stranger to these kinds of analogies. But the idea here is that it's a picture of an athlete pressing on with all of his might to get the laurel wreath at the end of his competition and be able to stand, as it were, on that podium and say, I did it. Yeah, the Olympics are coming up in Sochi, right? And we're going to be watching these games and everything. Of course, we become very accustomed to seeing people stand on a platform with a gold, silver, and bronze medal. You know, it's fun to watch. And we watch this, and oftentimes we're inspired by the athleticism and the feats of excellence and the preparation, the amazing precision with which these athletes can accomplish their goals. Well, that didn't come easy. That took years and years of work. You know, as a matter of fact, I saw a commercial this week. I don't remember who the athlete was, but she was talking about how this was like her fourth Olympics or something like that, and she was going to win a medal this time. And it was for some kind of a thing. I thought, this woman has not even won a medal, but I would be in awe of what she could accomplish. It's breathtaking to think of what goes into preparation to accomplish excellence in a sport. To stand on that podium and get the gold is the culmination of a lifetime of effort. Nobody trains by smoking cigarettes and stuffing down donuts and doing that kind of thing. They watch everything they eat. They commit every ounce of their being, every fiber of who they are, to the pursuit of reaching that platform, and nothing less will do. That's the picture that's being painted here. That's the idea. Paul is not using light words to help us understand, you know, what his intentions are in terms of Timothy pressing forth the effort that he wants him to see employed. Matter of fact, let's turn to 1 Corinthians for a moment, because really this is an echo of Paul's own heart. Chapter 9 of 1 Corinthians, we'll start in verse 16. I'll just read again a handful of verses here. Turn left a little bit here. We're in 1 Timothy. We're going to kind of make our way backward in the New Testament to 1 Corinthians. Sometimes I'll give people a hard time and say, okay, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, 1 Corinthians. You guys know that's not right. Okay, chapter 9 of 1 Corinthians, starting in verse 16. This is Paul writing of himself. For if I preach the gospel, I have nothing to boast of, for of necessity it is laid upon me. Yes, woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this willingly, I have a reward. But if it is against my will, I've been entrusted with a stewardship. What is my reward then? That when I preach the gospel, I may present the gospel of Christ without charge, and that I may not abuse my authority in the gospel. For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more. And to the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might win the Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, as without law, not being without law toward God, but under the law toward Christ, that I might win those who are without the law. To the weak I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Now this I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be partaker of it with you. Do you not know that those who run a race all run, but one receives the prize? Run it in such a way then that you may obtain it. And if anyone who competes for the prize is temperate, and everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. This does not sound like someone who took the easy route to spiritual success or simply clamored after a pulpit for the sake of gaining some notoriety. This is a person who left it all on the field. Okay? This is a guy who preached it like he stole it. Okay? This is a guy who meant everything and poured everything he was into everything he did. And he says, Timothy, I want you, in essence, to be like me. And at the end of your life, be able to say, I fought the good fight, I finished the race, I kept the faith. So again, back in 1 Timothy, fight the good fight of faith, lay hold of eternal life. Now when he's talking about laying hold of eternal life, he's not speaking of getting saved or coming to Christ. He is speaking in terms of that prize of which we spoke. Again, like he referred to even in 1 Corinthians 9, this idea that those who compete in athletics compete for that laurel wreath, for that prize there that perishes over time. But we struggle and strive for an imperishable crown. We pour ourselves into an effort that has a reward that is eternal. It is something that goes on before us. They say, that you can't take it with you, but you can send it up ahead. We struggle and strive for a crown that is imperishable, something that we will one day lay at the feet of Jesus on that glassy sea as we just sang about. This is what we strive for, to be able to have those things, to lay at his feet, to be able to say, we won, not against one another, but we finished our course and we finished strong. What did Paul say? I put my body under subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should be disqualified. Okay? Now, we don't live in fear. That shouldn't be our main motivation. But we should have a healthy sense of fear, if you will, of failing and falling short of what God has called us to. He's not put some guilt trip on us and called us to walk in legalism. But let's face it, none of those athletes, well, hopefully, the idea is that these folks, when they stand on the podium winning the gold medal, you hope they're not just doing it because mom and dad forced them and wouldn't relent until they got a gold. I mean, you can see it in their faces. They are relieved. They are ecstatic. They realize what they've accomplished, and they celebrate because the work paid off. Okay, they want it. They're hungry. What do you think Rocky climbed all those steps every morning and ate stuff that would make people puke and all this kind of thing? So he could stand at the top of that thing and raise his arms, and we look at that, we get inspired by it. Then at the end of the thing, he didn't even win the fight, but he finished. That was his goal, right? I'm not shy to use a movie analogy. Y'all know what I'm talking about. That feeling, that sense of, I got there, I did it. That's what it's all about. We're motivated by a drive to one day hear, well done, good and faithful servant. You know, John, of course, reminds us in his letter that, you know, those of us who believe in the name of the Son of God, the Son of God, have eternal life. It's a finished thing. We're not, again, talking of acquiring. We're talking about laying hold of. We're talking about pressing on and going after that very thing that represents an eternal prize. Now, he goes on here in verse 13. He says, actually the end of verse 12, this is also something that you have confessed, a good confession, the presence of many witnesses. Okay, so Timothy here, this is a gold star, if you will. Timothy, you've been faithful to do what's expected of you. You have been a good witness. You have borne a good testimony. Nevertheless, he goes on to encourage him and say, I urge you in the sight of God who gives life to all things, and before Christ Jesus who witnessed the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep this commandment without spot, blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ's appearing. I charge you, I order you, I command you, to hold fast to this confession, this commandment, to not falter, to not waver. Again, Timothy is somebody who faced opposition in ministry. Any of you who've ever served in ministry know what opposition feels like. You know what it's like to have people press against you and try to keep you from moving forward for one reason or another. Of course, the devil himself, whether he himself or those who serve under his, you know, authority, the demons and those minions that is in his you know, under his authority, they will seek to undermine the work that you do for the kingdom of God. And if you've ever tried an endeavor for Christ, you know what opposition feels like. Timothy knew this feeling. I've said it many times, but again, for those who may not have been with us along this journey here, in Ephesus, it was a place of, it was a high level of godlessness. There was a lot of idolatry. Diana, the statue of Diana was there. It was just this place that was difficult in ministry. It wasn't just inner city ministry. That's hard enough. But it was inner city ministry that was revolved around the extremely lewd worship of a goddess named Diana. Now imagine being a pastor in that kind of town where every day everybody in your church went to work and went about their business in the midst of a city that was basically like the red light district in the Netherlands or something like that. Just horrible. That's his ministry. That's hard. That's uphill. That's difficult. No wonder Paul says to push on and to strain and to wrestle and leave it all in the field in this effort, because anything less would not result in the kind of fruit that Timothy no doubt wanted, Paul no doubt wanted, and that Jesus was giving him the power to help bring to bear. I order you to hold fast to these things, this testimony that you have borne witness to, the same testimony that Jesus Christ himself bore before Pontius Pilate. I love that. You know, it's not just that God has told us in his word just a number of things that we ought to do in ministry. He points to Jesus and say, do what Jesus did. Follow in his footsteps and be faithful to do it. You know, in Hebrews, Jesus is called the author and the finisher of our faith. The word author speaks, it's a word that you would use if you're describing somebody who is blazing a trail. And when I read that passage, I often think about, you know, somebody who's hacking their way with a machete through the brush of a jungle, a deep, dark, dense full, you just can't see where you're going, but it's okay because the guy in front of you knows where he's going and he's clearing a path. All that really remains for you is to walk on that path behind him so that you don't turn from the right or to the left and get lost in this brush and never find your way back. You will get to the other side if you follow him. He's the author, okay? He's the one who blazes the trail, but he's also the finisher. He's the one who will be faithful to complete that in you which he has begun. He's the one who will never let anyone snatch you out of his hands. He's the one who, if you will simply surrender to him, will not be shotgun in the front seat. He will drive this thing to where it needs to go, and he will take you to the places that you need to go that you might grow. He is the author and the finisher. Okay? Paul points to Jesus when he's encouraging Timothy and saying, this thing you've been doing, standing and holding fast your testimony, continue on that. Keep your eyes on Jesus who did that very thing himself. He set a pattern. Now you hold fast and follow him, even though it's hard, even though it's difficult, even though you feel like sometimes you want to throw in the towel. Timothy could look at Jesus' boldness as an encouragement to be bold himself. Jesus, who gives life to all things. Continuing on, he says, that you would keep this commandment without spot, blameless, until our Lord Jesus Christ's appearing. Not just his coming, but his appearing. Which he will manifest in his own time. He who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, dwelling in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. You know, I cannot help, especially with the word amen coming at the end of this particular phrase and stanza, if you will, that Paul has moved from instruction to worship. He has moved from simply just sharing theology and giving some instruction. He has moved very smoothly and comfortably into doxology. He has moved into a place of worship. He's thinking about the Lord that he's encouraging Timothy to follow without wavering. That inspires me. You know, it reminds me of something very important. Our faith is not one that is simply rooted in making sure we follow the rules the right way. Our faith is rooted and completely connected to the person of Jesus Christ, who is the most beautiful and worthy person that has ever lived. He is God incarnate in flesh, and nobody can inspire you like him. And we should never allow ourselves to fall short of simply serving without recognizing the adoration that motivates us to want to serve him. We all remember the story of Mary and Martha, and we sometimes give Martha a hard time. She was serving Jesus because she loved him. She didn't not love him, but just she was serving and serving and serving, and that busyness got in the way of something even better than her service to him. And Mary had adopted that part. She had gotten down, sat at his feet, and just wanted to hear the sweet voice of her Savior. She just wanted to be near him. It wasn't about what she could do for him. It was about just being near him. If there was ever a picture of what Jesus would look for in us, it's that. Matter of fact, he even said so. Mary has chosen the better part because she has simply chosen to sit at my feet. You know, sometimes we very easily let our service get in the way of genuine worship. But sometimes we feel like, well, this is how I communicate with God. This is how I relate to God. And there's a place for service, no doubt. You know, there's a place for us doing stuff for Jesus. That's not a bad idea. But that's not where he wants our relationship with him to end. It's not an end in itself. There's a much deeper call upon the lives of the children of God, and that is to come and fellowship with him, to commune with him, to spend time with him, recognizing that he has not separated himself from us, but he desires for us to draw near, to be with him, to enjoy his presence, to listen for his voice, to lift our hearts in worship to him as we get to know him better. This is what lies in front of us as an opportunity as Christians. We don't have to simply be satisfied with, okay, I went to church, I threw some stuff in the money box, I supported a missionary or something like that. Those things are wonderful. They have their place. You ought to come to church. You know, you ought to be supporting missions and stuff like that. But if that is as deep as your relationship with Christ goes, I would challenge you to take a deep look inside your heart and say, why am I doing this? Is it out of a sense of duty? Or is it out of response to the loving care and just the drawing of the Lord himself, the desire to be with him? This is just how I honor you, but it's not what my relationship's about. If you ran out of money tomorrow, would you still be able to relate to God? calls us to something far deeper. He breaks into this moment of spontaneous worship. And I think it's a glimpse into what makes Paul's heart tick, really. You know, Paul is somebody who, and you read through his letters, and you reckon there are these points where he just sort of either breaks into a moment of praise like this, or he just shares something about what motivates him. You know, in Philippians, he talks about how, you know, I want to know Jesus and the power of his resurrection, but not just there, but also being conformed to his death. You know, the deepest kind of fellowship. I even want to experience his kind of sufferings, that I might know him better. Paul was not sadistic. He wasn't just looking for, you know, I'm going to be a Christian and just go through suffering because that's what it's all about. No, it wasn't like that. But there was a purpose in it. His desire was to endure whatever it took to draw close to him. Nothing was worth missing if it allowed him to draw closer. And this is the kind of heart that Paul is encouraging Timothy to take on himself as a young man. Paul, Timothy, you're going to have years of ministry ahead of you. You know, I know, again, and as we've said many times, it's going to be hard, it can be very difficult, but if this motivation is not there, it's going to be very hard for you to keep the command without spot and blameless until the Lord's appearing. As a matter of fact, Paul would write in Galatians, "Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart." If we do not lose heart, okay? If we don't have something at the heart, at the core of our motivation that fuels this fire and passion, we will always fall short because we won't feel like we're in it for the right reasons. We'll eventually question. We'll eventually back away. We'll taper down. We'll begin to backslide. Why? Because we've lost, in a sense, like Jesus himself would say in Revelation, we've lost our first love. It's like this. There are those that when they, and probably all of us fit into this at some point, but we come to Christ and we just can't stay out of church. I want to hear God's word. I want to be around God's people. I want to sing. There's something about this that just draws me, and I want to be there every chance I get. Yeah, there's 5 Bible studies going on a week. I'm going to be in every one of them. I just can't get enough. Well, eventually, over time, you know, I'm still going to a Bible study. I'm showing up to church and everything like that. I love the Lord. I'm worshiping. Well, then all of a sudden, something comes up, and you know, I'm there for most Sundays, you know, for worship. I don't get the Bible studies, but I do listen to the podcasts, and I go to church at least a couple times a month and everything. Well, you know, after all, I can't just listen to the podcast on Sunday mornings. After all, they're streaming it now. Why even come in? You see the progression or the digression? Eventually, it just becomes, okay, well, I'm still doing it, but I'm not really passionate anymore. You know, we've left our first love at that point. We've left our first love. It speaks of walking away. It speaks of letting it go, of it no longer holding the place that it once did. I'm not talking about making sure that you warm up a seat every Sunday, but I'm talking about what drives you to come and to fellowship with the people of God and to lift your hearts to him and to clamor for the word of God, to hunger for it with such passion that you feel like if I don't get it this morning, I feel like I've missed something. I really want it. This is what drives the heart of somebody who loves the Lord. You just can't get enough of him. And wherever he calls you to be, you want to be. And Paul worships. It's like you can't help it. But what motivates this? What fuels this passion of Paul's? I think he kind of spells it out here. We look again at starting in verse 15. He reminds us that Jesus will one day appear. Okay, his appearing, which he will manifest in his own time. Jesus will, in fact, one day appear. Paul looks forward to this. Matter of fact, when we read in the book of Acts, we read of the event in the book of Acts, but Paul later writes of a man that he knew that, you know, whether he was in the body or out, this man went to the third heaven, and he saw things that were unlawful for him to even utter. And we think Paul is talking about himself. In the book of Acts, we see where Paul is stoned outside of Jerusalem and left for dead, and he possibly did die. Imagine being Paul in that circumstance, and he goes and he sees heaven, and he sees things that they're too great for him to even try to describe. It'd be a crime to try and describe what I'm seeing in this place. And all of a sudden, he finds himself kind of getting pulled back as the disciples are around him praying for him, and he comes back. Do you think Paul wanted to come back? I wouldn't have wanted to come back. You know, I get it. You know, Paul is saying, look, whether it's better to stay here with you or to go be with the Lord, yeah, I don't know, man, but I guess I'll stay and do what I got to do until Jesus brings me home, but I really, really want to be there. Okay? But we understand that. But Paul looked forward to the day when Jesus would come back for him, the day when he appears. Now, of course, you know, we understand the Bible teaches of 2 separate comings of Jesus. One is the rapture, where he comes halfway here, as it were, meets us in the air and snatches us away, but we will see him at that appearing. But then, of course, there is the second coming as well. My view here is that Jesus, he's thinking about being snatched away. But he says here he's looking forward to. This is one of the motivations for his worship, if you will. This idea that his appearing will come in his own time. What about that? Why is that important? I think for at least two reasons. One is that his coming validates your service. Everything you've poured into to walking with him, putting yourself, as we've said before, leaving yourself on the field, leaving it all out there, that's validated when he comes back. Oh my gosh, you weren't crazy. He really is coming back. He really is the Lord that you said he was. It validates the fact that you have poured yourself into this thing, but it also tells us that he will be there at the end of the journey. And when he finally calls us home, whether it's by rapture or by death, he will be there to receive us. I'm reminded of Stephen as he is being martyred there in early in the book of Acts. When here's Saul, our first glimpse of Saul is somebody who is, holding the coats of those who want to stone Stephen, and he wants to drag people into prison and this kind of thing. Well, here is Stephen, the church's first martyr. He's serving tables, and then he finds himself brought before the leadership of Israel, and he professes Christ and gives one of the best Old Testament history lessons you'll find throughout chapter 7. But he confesses Christ boldly before them, and finally the people go crazy and they stone him. And as he is dying, and like Jesus, he says, "Don't hold this against their charge." He looks up, and as they begin to stone him, he sees heaven open, and he says, "There I see the Son of Man standing at the right hand of the Father." We often see Jesus sitting at the right hand of the Father, but it's as if Jesus stood up to welcome him home. Jesus is there at the end of the journey, and we will see him, and that's exciting. I think another motivation for Paul was that he recognized Jesus for who he was. The only potentate, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. All powers one day will crumble before him. Potentate ultimately speaks of one with power, overarching power, all-consuming power. He is the absolute final word of all authority. This is the idea. And Paul recognizes him this way. And in recognizing that, he understands that for all of the opposition he will face in this world, one day the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. One day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. In fact, Daniel in chapter 2, there's a vision of this very thing. One day, Nebuchadnezzar gets a vision. Daniel is ultimately given the opportunity to interpret this. And of course, we remember the statue, this idea of this head of gold that represented Babylon, this chest and arms of silver that represented the Medes and the Persians, the stomach and thighs of bronze that represented the Greeks, the legs of iron that represented Rome, and ultimately this 10 toes, this iron mixed with clay and this revived Roman Empire. But at the end of that description, at the end of the vision that Nebuchadnezzar saw, he saw a stone cut without hands coming from the heavens that smashed at the feet of this idol and brought the whole thing down. Now Daniel interprets this and he explains how one kingdom will come after another and everything, but one day, in the day of these final kings, these 10 toes, these 10 confederated nations under a one world government, Jesus will come and establish his kingdom and he will crush that kingdom. He will bring it down, and every kingdom that is invested and led to that point, every philosophy and view that is ultimately led to the point where Jesus' kingdom comes will be destroyed in that time. He will set up a kingdom that has no end. There's nothing that comes after that rock not cut with hands. Okay, one day, every nation of this world will recognize Jesus for who he is. So hang in there. It's not if, it's when. Read the end of the book. He wins. Like all good textbook, the answer is from the back. And that's the best answer. It also says, by the way, in that passage in Daniel 2, that not only will he come and crush and set up his kingdom that will last forever, but the previous kingdoms will sort of blow away like chaff, insubstantial as they were, especially in the light of the most substantial. So he recognizes Jesus for who he is. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is the only potentate. Now he goes on here. He speaks of Jesus, who is the one who alone has immortality. He holds the keys of eternal life. He didn't just die and rise from the dead and that's he just attained eternal life. He is the one who holds the keys of everlasting life. As a matter of fact, Peter in John chapter 6, everybody's leaving after Jesus once again thins out the ranks in his ministry. He doesn't simply want people to follow him just so they can say they're part of the crowd following Jesus. He thins out the ranks so that those who are sincerely following him Even though they don't fully get everything, they're following him for the right reasons. They believe he is who he's claiming to be. They believe something about him that he's different. It's not about what they get, it's about wanting to follow Jesus. So he thins out the ranks. And finally, it's just basically his disciples at this particular gathering. And he says, well, how about you guys? You want to go away too? And Peter, one of these moments of brilliance, he says, you know, to where shall we go? Or to whom shall we go? You are the one who has the words of eternal life. It's not something he attained. It's not something he learned in school or off in the Far East at some point in those missing years of his life. It's none of that. He came from eternity. The Word became flesh. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 1:1 and John 14, and he came and he dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. There was something different about Jesus. He didn't just get born into the world. He was from eternity past. As a matter of fact, in Isaiah, when we read of this coming one, he is called the Father of eternity. Everlasting Father speaks of one who is the Father of eternity. He is from everlasting to everlasting. He is somebody who is completely different than anyone else who has ever walked the face of the earth. He didn't gain eternal life. He is the fountain of eternal life. And that gives us hope, because we understand that when Jesus says, no one will snatch you out of my hands, but I give eternal life to you, we know that it's going to be ours to inherit one day. He goes on. Dwelling in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, and to whom will be honor and everlasting power. Amen. He says, above all things, he dwells in an unapproachable light, which no man has seen or can see, speaking of his holiness and his purity. Do you realize, when we say Jesus is awesome, that's not just like a phrase. He is awesome. He is awe-inspiring. He is magnificent. He is the very definition of lofty and high and other and majestic. Okay? O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. That's a response to recognizing the glory of God. He dwells in a light that is unapproachable. John tells us in his first epistle that in him is light and no darkness at all. In Isaiah chapter 6, the seraphim, as Isaiah is having this encounter, seeing the Lord high and lifted up, his robe is seen just flowing in the temple, and then the seraphim, who we get confused, or we don't get everything between seraphim and cherubim in this, but the seraphim have six wings. That's one distinction that seems to be made between them and cherubim. The seraphim, with two of their wings they fly, with two they cover their feet, and with two they cover their faces as they cry out, holy, holy, holy. And they worship the Lord in the presence of Isaiah as he gets this glimpse of heaven. God is high and lofty. The one who spoke shakes the heavens, Isaiah records. There is something just beyond next description going on here. There is something that, to the best of his ability, he's trying to let us in on. But it is something that is just beyond him. It's something that causes him to fall on his face and recognize, woe is me, I am undone. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell among people with unclean lips. I am undone. I'm destroyed here in your presence. We lose that sense of the awesomeness of God. And you know what? Jesus is not somehow less than that. Rabbi, turn to Revelation chapter 5. We went to this passage during our series, Engage. But it's very fitting to go back to it now. Revelation chapter 5. Revelation chapter 5, let's go ahead and read verse 13. Now, there's a worship service going on in heaven right here, but I want you to notice the equality that is given to Christ here, both in person and also in worship. Verse 13, and every creature which is under heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea and all that are in them, I heard saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever. If you look earlier in verse chapter 4, you've got verse 8. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Verse 11, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. Chapter 5, verse 9, you are worthy, take the scroll and to open its seals, and you were slain, and you have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe, tongue, and people, and nation and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth. Verse 12, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. It's like this crescendo is being reached as they worship the Lamb of God, who of course is Jesus. And they worship him equal with the Father. They worship him as God because God is triune. Father, Son, and Spirit receive this worship as God. They are glorious. They are deserving. And those in heaven cannot help but worship. Of the cherubs around the throne, it says that they worship him day and night without ceasing. I don't think they ever get bored. I don't think they think of that job and say, guys, I wish we had a little more variety. No, they can't help themselves. They love him. They're impassioned by him as they see him. This is our God. He's worthy of adoration because he is absolutely beautiful, perfect, and holy. He's everything we're not or could ever hope to be. And because he is, he draws us. We want to be like him. We want to love him. We see him, we can't help but be undone, but at the same time, we can't help but want to be near him. If it weren't for what Jesus accomplished on the cross, before we move on, I should make the point. It says that he dwells in an unapproachable light. Unapproachable. Throughout history in the Old Testament, there was a picture of God that was rooted in his holiness. You remember reading, of course, if you come on Thursday nights, you listen, we're going to get there very soon, where Moses and Joshua, they come to the mount, Mount Sinai. They're going to receive the Ten Commandments from God. He's going to speak to them. It's not just the Ten Commandments, but ultimately 613, there's going to be a blueprints for the tabernacle that will go in the wilderness, given to Moses and all these things. It's going to be an amazing event. But of this meeting place, only Moses and Joshua were able to come up and to go to that place. And Joshua didn't go all the way up and see God. Joshua kind of went to a point. But Moses went up and met with God. But to the multitude in general, God told Moses to make sure that the people did not come to this mountain or touch it. Because as this holy darkness consumed the top of this mountain, as Moses met with God, the lightnings and the thunderings that are described in this place, there was a fearsome aspect of this meeting. It was awe-inspiring, but there was a fear that came on. Reverence, yes. Worship, yes. But they were afraid as well. You don't just walk up and just touch God or come to the place where he is casually, or we're just like, I can just climb this mountain. That's where God is, and that's where I want to be, so I'm just going to go. No, it's not like that. As a matter of fact, we're comfortable in the New Testament economy coming to a place of intimacy with God in prayer, or maybe in this place in worship, and we spend time drawing close to God and everything. We don't always think of this side of the whole thing. We come very casually. We think in Hebrews where it says, we can now therefore come boldly before the throne of grace to obtain mercy in our time of need. We sometimes view that as being a casual thing. We can just show up whenever we feel like it. It's okay, I want to meet with God, now is the time. Yes, we have access to God freely and openly. When the veil was torn from top to bottom, this thick veil that was formidable, it was intended to let people know that you don't pass this line. But God opened it himself from top to bottom. When Jesus gave up his spirit, it says that this veil in the temple was rent from top to bottom. It's as if God was saying, now you can come. That which stood between you and I has been dealt with. It's been paid for. That doesn't mean we can just go casually. It doesn't mean that we just walk in like it doesn't matter that we're there. It's just that it's like going to the movies or something. It's not. It's different. A time of worship is a sacred thing. It's a time when we gather and we open our hearts to God because he has allowed us to come to that place of intimacy with him. He has called us to come and not to just feel like, you know, like we have to be afraid to come, but we should never lose the reverence that comes with meeting with God. Even though we can stand, as it were, literally, we've been invited to come and stand where Moses stood. But we shouldn't feel like we deserve it, or that we can just, it's just like some other thing in our lives. You know? He dwells in an unapproachable light. If not for the finished work of Christ on your behalf and mine, it would still be unapproachable. You still would not be able to cross that line. But because he did, we can come. That is a glorious truth that we should embrace and frankly should just get excited about. Don't ever be afraid to lift your hands and sing louder. I don't care if you can sing or not.
I'm of the belief that God chooses to be tone deaf in worship time so that nobody has to be afraid to sing. Just lift your hearts to God and sing. I mean, I'm not putting a thing on you. I'm just saying, don't be afraid. Don't feel inhibited because you have a privilege that's been given to you. But just make sure you recognize what that privilege really is. And by the way, when you do, you will worship Him in a way that you maybe never have experienced outside of that recognition. It's a beautiful privilege. And lastly, in verse 16, again, He alone has immortality, dwelling in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. As we said before already, He will one day receive the honor due His name. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Paul recognizes these things, and at the end of the just considering these things, contemplating the truths behind these words, as he's either writing or dictating them here to Timothy, he just can't help but worship. I wonder if he was dictating this to somebody, and they're trying to keep up with him as he's saying all this stuff. You know, I mean, he's just worshiping now. It's not about writing letters anymore. It's about praising the Lord, and all these things are coming to his mind, and he can't help but worship at the end. I don't think it was just, okay, now write amen. I think it was amen. He was overwhelmed. Amen. Now he goes on in that same place of worshiping. He doesn't all of a sudden just leave it, but he goes on and says, now command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty or to be self-minded or high-minded, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good that they may be rich in good works, ready to give and willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold of eternal life. There's that idea again. Not that they might be saved, but that they might pour everything that they have into the pursuit of that which will not perish. He says, speak to those that have means, those who are rich in this current age. Tell them to beware of two particular dangers. One is the idea here of allowing your wealth or your means to become an impediment to your spiritual progress. To know that money is not the root of all evil. What did we read last time that Paul wrote to Timothy? The love of money, right? It's no problem for you to have money. If you work hard, you got a great income, you got a nice place to live, that's fine. But when that becomes something that you begin to crave and seek to protect more than your relationship with Christ, or if God puts his finger on something that is of value to you, you will not let it go. Paul says, beware, beware. That is not where your treasure lies. We know the story of the rich young ruler. He had this very problem. You know, young guy comes to Christ one day, comes to Jesus, and he says, good teacher, what must I do to be saved? Now, we call him the rich young ruler because he was wealthy, he was a younger guy, and as a ruler, we imply that he was possibly a leader in a synagogue. Okay, this is a guy who, by most standards, had it all together. But he recognized he didn't have everything. So he comes to Jesus and says, what do I have to do to have eternal life? And of course, we know Jesus, I love this, but he confronts the question with a question. Why do you call me good? I mean, let's get this laid out first. Why is it that you're calling me good? There's no one good but God. So A, why are you asking me in the first place? Or B, do you recognize me for who I am? And if so, are you going to listen to what I say? He said, go obey the commandments. Well, I've done this since my youth. You know, what do I still lack? Notice all the commandments he says, Jesus lays out for him, are all the ones that deal with man's relationship with man. He doesn't touch on the ones that have to do with man's relationship with God, because that's coming. He says, now, okay, well, fine. You've kept these things since your youth. Even lay aside that he may have been a little cocky about that. Maybe it's true. Jesus puts his finger on the real heart of the issue. Look, all your interrelation, all the stuff of this world that you feel like you have done right has gotten you to the place where you're standing in front of me asking me, what must you have to do to gain eternal life? Here's what you have to do. Sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and then come follow me. He was not laying out a mandate for everybody with money. He was laying out a position that this man needed to take. Why? Because this man's money was his God. You need to get rid of this before you can ever follow me. He who puts his hand on the plow and looks back is not ready to be pushing that plow. He's not ready to come to work for me. Say goodbye to your parents? Let me go say goodbye to my father first. The implication was not that Jesus was keeping him from the funeral. The thing was, the guy's father was not dead yet. He was not going to die yet. He just wanted to wait till it was a more convenient time to follow Jesus. Let the dead go bury their own dead. You can go. You're not ready. That doesn't sound like a lot of our pulpits today. Jesus, look, if you're not going to follow me for the right reasons, you're not really following me at all. If he's not the Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. And Paul here tells Timothy, tell those that have riches, those who are rich in his present age, not to be haughty. Don't think that your identity is found in your, or don't let your identity be found in your riches. That's a good question. If you have means, you should stop and ask yourself, is this my God or not? I'm not implying that it is, by the way. But if it is, we need to deal with that. It needs to be set aside and put in its proper context, in its proper place in your life. Because you cannot take that with you. Therefore, it ought not be your identity today. Paul calls it the uncertainty of riches. You know, I've never had a lot of money, so when the stock market crashed and everybody went into recession, that didn't hit me too hard. But a lot of people it did. And it, I mean, not that it, we didn't feel it like anybody else. I mean, suddenly, you know, I mean, we had to kind of look at some stuff. But for a lot of people who have lots and lots of money, suddenly this was a catastrophe. And I don't say that in a smarmy way. I'm just saying that this was an example of the uncertainty of putting your trust in worldly treasures, because they really are here today and gone tomorrow. There's no guarantee that this will be there tomorrow. You know, Jesus told another story about a guy who had so much grain that he eventually felt like, you know, his silos were overflowing. He thought, well, I know what I'll do. I'll tear down these silos. I'll build bigger ones to store all my stuff. This guy's head was not even in the game. The Lord shows up to him that night and says, you fool. Tonight your life's going to be required of you. Where's all this going to matter? What's it going to matter? Where's it going to go? This man's life was not about anything but what he had in terms of worldly possessions. Paul says, tell those who have worldly possessions in this life to be careful, to be mindful, to recognize that they are uncertain. They ought not trust in them. They ought not find their identity in them. But rather, our trust needs to be in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Okay? In other words, God gives us what we need or what he sees as best for us, and he gives it to us to enjoy. But those things, if they are not given from God, can be an absolute impediment to your walking with him. Be mindful. Now, Timothy's part, you know, some of these folks with money might be the very same people who thought he was too young to be pastoring. Go tell them, oh gosh, really? I have to do this? Yes. Why? Because you're doing them a service. Because ultimately, if they want to walk with God, they will want to hear these words. They will want to walk with God. Now again, the problem is not having money. That's never an issue. Having it's not the problem. When it has you, that's a problem. Paul here shows the other side of the use of money. On one hand, it can be an impediment to our, or even a distraction to our growing with the Lord. But on the other hand, those with resources have the potential to do great kingdom work. What does he say in verse 18? Let them do good that they may be rich in good works, ready to give and willing to share, and therefore storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold of eternal life. In other words, if you have means, if you have resources, it's not my place to tell you what to do with them, except to encourage you to do this. Invest them in what God is doing, and let that be what you focus your attention on, because in doing so, those good works you're doing with them are laying, basically, the steps that you are taking toward reaching the platform. One day you will obtain the prize, and this will be part of the work that you put into getting to that place. Not this is going to buy your salvation, but this is what shows the Lord that you're in this race to win it. You know? In Hebrews, it talks about laying aside any sin or weight that so easily besets us. Sin is one thing. If we're living in such a way that we are just hampering our own walk with God because of a sinful part of our lifestyle, that's one thing. But weights can be anything. Weights can be anything that holds you down from running the race with endurance. And again, you know, Paul is not saying it's wrong to have money. But if that money is putting weight on your back and keeping you from moving forward, then you need to think about what you're doing with it. And instead of letting it be an impediment, let it be something that you can use as part of your walking with God and running the race. Invest in those things that God would direct you to invest it in, and not just hoard it for yourself and let it become your identity. That can be an extremely dangerous place to be. Now he closes out this letter here in verses 20 and 21. O Timothy, guard what was committed to your trust, avoiding the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. By professing it, some have strayed, concerning the faith. Pastors, and again, this is written to a pastor named Timothy, a young guy who is leading a church or a body of believers, and Paul is reminding him that pastors have been given a sacred trust. There is a responsibility that God has called pastors to take on their shoulders and not to shy away from. And Paul is reminding Timothy of this. Part of guarding that sacred trust is avoiding the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. Now, I have a philosophical bent, okay? I like to get to the bottom of things and work out not just the outward expression of a worldview or an idea, but I like to get to the heart of it. I like to get down to what really ultimately is at the base. One of the things I love to delve into is the subject of atheism, because there are many facets to it, but ultimately there is a core that can be reached if you think these things all the way through their logical conclusion. And I like to kind of live in that world of thinking about things. However, one of the dangers that can come up is that you can begin to allow the ideas that you know have been given to you through God's word, things that you know are true, can suddenly now start to find cracks in them as you begin to allow other philosophies and worldviews to inform your way of thinking. It's one thing to see them and expose them, as Paul would say in Galatians, to expose the unfruitful works of darkness, and that kind of thing, to understand them, but to allow them to inform your own thinking is a dangerous thing. Now, as a pastor, you are confronted with many, many ideas. I remember years ago, Pastor Phil, my pastor in Chicago, we were there after a Thursday night, and a guy came up after service on a Thursday night, and he just started talking, and I knew this guy, but he started talking to Pastor Phil, and he didn't know where he was coming from on anything. He's talking about one thing, and then he drops a pen, and he says, "Now, why did I do that?" And he starts going this whole kind of thing. And we're sitting there scratching our heads thinking, what on earth? Now, you can get involved in that kind of discussion and just completely go down any rabbit trail that somebody brings up and get lost in all this kind of stuff and completely get off track of what you should be doing. Timothy, pastor, or Brian, pastor, any pastor, you can go down these rabbit trails and get completely wildly distracted, but that is not what our calling is to do. Okay, what does he say here? Don't get involved and reject profane and idle babblings. In other words, useless arguments worthy of being trodden underfoot. That's kind of the idea that's being conveyed here in the Greek. Something that is not worth the time to discuss and is basically just fodder to be walked on, just left behind. It's insignificant. Contradictions. We get our word antithesis and knowledge from the root words that basically formulate around this idea of contradictions. It speaks of opposing sorts of pseudo-knowledge that attempt to be accepted as genuine knowledge. In other words, sometimes people try to be so deep that they don't realize that there's really nothing behind what they're saying. There's no fire behind the smoke. There's no substance behind the stylistic renderings that they're bringing to the table. And Paul says to Timothy, don't get wrapped up in this kind of stuff, because if you do, first off, those that get wrapped up in these things at the expense of the truth that God has already revealed, that which we know to be true, they oftentimes find themselves in spiritual shipwreck because they've gone down some other road. Timothy, don't let yourself get caught up in this kind of thing. You have been given something that you need to guard and you need to help protect other people from, as they can be oftentimes misled by these ideas. And so again, there is this charge that is given to pastors to be able to sort of, A, distinguish the difference between truth and all these crazy ideas that you feel like someone feels like you need to defend. And then there's also the importance of protecting others in the church to make sure they don't fall prey to it. Okay? Of course I'm a fan of deep thinking. Of course I love to have discussions that go beyond just very simple ideas and concepts. Nevertheless, not all of them will be fruitful. And we need to avoid those that are unfruitful. And he ends the letter. Grace be with you. Why? Because you're going to need it, brother. Grace is necessary in every aspect of ministry. We need God's grace personally, but we also need to be people who will extend grace as we are called to lead. Okay? There ought never be such a thing as an imperial pastorate. Someone who doesn't have time for the sheep and, look, if you're not where I'm at, then we don't have time to talk. Let me just shuffle you off to one of the assistant pastors, a lesser person who can handle your kinds of issues. No, there ought never be anything like that, okay? There ought to be grace extended. Even if someone is a brand new believer and they have 1,000 questions and they're all so simple, good. Sit down, talk to them, be gracious, extend everything that Jesus would extend if you were sitting in the seat you're warming up right now, and make sure that you're gracious, because after all, you are going to need grace yourself. You know, show mercy, be kind. Recognize that you were in that same place at one time. And also, I would see in this basically something that I would ask of you all, and that is simply to pray for me as well. I need your grace as well, because the truth is told, I will let you down at some point. If I haven't already, at some point I will probably let you down. Something will happen in your life that I will have missed, and you will wonder why I didn't call you. You know, something will slip my mind. As much as I try to keep a good, solid day plan and all this kind of thing, something may happen where I may let you down. Okay? And this is not an example of this. I was not made to feel like I let anybody down this, but this was a moment where I realized, like, I really appreciate any grace extended to me, but someone in our church had a mini stroke in November, and I had no idea. I just found out, like, 3 days ago. And I felt horrible about that. I thought, oh, my God, how can something like that happen? And I didn't know about it for 2 months, okay? And again, it didn't make me feel bad about it. They didn't tell me about it. But it was just, but you know, there may come up something in your life that maybe I missed something. I wasn't there for you when you needed me. I would hope you would just extend a little bit of grace, because I do want to be there for you. And just, you know, this grace goes both ways, you know? And that's I think, what, you know, as Paul wraps up his letter here, he says, grace be with you. Amen. Amen. Now, the whole point of ministry, next week we'll start 2 Timothy, but the whole point of ministry is not the ministry itself. It's the person of Christ. At the end of every service, my desire is that you know Jesus better than you did when you came in the door. At the end of every time we get together for fellowship, my hope is that we have seen Christ in each other, or the better for having God together. That's the end goal, is that we might know him and be more like him. But there might be some here, or maybe you've heard my voice, that have never come to Christ in the first place. And so at the end of every service, I like to take just a few moments and just give an invitation for any who have not come to Christ themselves. What does that even mean? Well, if you're here or you're listening to this at some later date, here's what I'm talking about. Every one of us are sinners. Pastors, those in the pulpits, those in the pews, we're all sinners. We've all come to Christ the same way. There's a narrow road that leads to the foot of the cross, apart from which there is no salvation. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And nobody comes to the Father except through me. So whatever you think about Jesus, you have to contend with the fact that he made a very extremely exclusive claim. Now again, I like philosophy, so I would just simply throw out the fact that every religion at some point makes an exclusive truth claim. So we're not unique in that way. The question is, which one is true? They can't all be true at the same time. There's plenty of reason. We did part of a series on this whole thing, but there's plenty of reason to come to the point where you recognize that Jesus is exactly who he said he was. He is God incarnate. He is the one who has come from heaven to walk on the face of the earth, not only to teach, though he taught the most profound things ever. He didn't come simply to feed and do miracles, though his miracles were almost innumerable. John said there's not enough room for all the books in the world that could be written on everything Jesus did. But John himself said, the things that I've chosen to write to you, I've chosen to write so that you might know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that believing in him, you might have eternal life. And that's the Jesus I'm bringing to you today. He's the purpose for this ministry, and he's the purpose for the ministry that Paul was encouraging Timothy to continue on in. Jesus came out of heaven, walked among men, ultimately to make his way to the cross. From the moment the incarnation took place, he was on a march to the cross. That sounds dreary and heavy, and it is, because you and I deserve to be on that cross. Every one of us deserves to be separated from God, literally in a place called hell that Jesus himself said was never created for man, it was created for the devil and his angels. Nevertheless, those who reject God and reject Christ, his Savior, for our sins, have no other alternative. There's no middle ground. There's no place for undecideds. There's a heaven and there's a hell, and we all have a choice where we're going to go. And Jesus has come to make the way that we might stand with God forever, forgiven. We'll never work our way. We'll never pay for our own sins. There is no amount of good you can ever do to expunge the sin of your life. And because that is a hopeless dilemma, even as the disciples said, like, who can be saved? And Jesus said, with man, it's impossible. Okay? What else do you need to hear? With man, it's impossible. You cannot do it yourself. And he knows. Matter of fact, Paul said, if righteousness comes by the law, then Jesus died for nothing, needlessly. There is no other way. Jesus himself prayed in the garden, Father, if there is any other way, let this cup pass by me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. The fact that there was no answer given, no other way was presented, tells me that Not that the Father wasn't listening, but that there was no other way. And so now we understand that. It behooves us then to make the choice. Will I surrender to Him? Will I give my heart, my life, my mind, all that I am, will I give it to Him and allow Him to save me? Or will I continue down the road I'm on that ultimately leads to destruction? Jesus said there are two roads. Don't ever accuse Jesus of being narrow-minded. Don't buy into this, we're all taking roads to get to the same place. The problem with that is that everyone says we're going to the same place. Jesus said you've got a choice. And I would tell you to choose the narrow road that leads to everlasting life. How do we do that? We confess our sin to Him. We recognize that in any sin we've ever committed, any wrong we've ever done, we've done to other people, but ultimately we've done it to Him because He's the one who clarified for us and said, look, that is sin. You need to understand it. And in doing so, you understand that you've not just offended your neighbor, you've offended me. I'm the one who gave the law that you broke. If we confess our sins, the Bible tells us in 1 John, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He is faithful. He will do it every time. And He's just. He didn't just wink at sin or push it aside like it was no big deal. He paid for it. He is faithful and He is just. All that remains is for you to come and believe. Because God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him would not perish but have everlasting life. That is good news. And so I want to give you an invitation right now. If you're ready to come before the Lord, if you recognize that you are a sinner, I'm not going to promise you a rosy life. I'm not going to promise you that every problem will go away. I'm only going to promise you that the biggest problem you have will have been dealt with. And you can look forward to the everlasting life that we spoke about today. You will know the God that you will desire and worship, that like we spoke about today. You will walk with Jesus and He will walk with you. If you're ready to give up the old life and allow Him to make you new, then I would invite you to pray along with me. We just all keep our heads bowed for a moment. As we close in prayer, I'll give this invitation. Father, we thank You, Lord, for meeting with us this morning in Your word and in worship and in fellowship. We thank You, Father, that You have come to draw us close to Yourself. And that, Father, You give meaning in life and purpose that cannot be found anywhere else. Because You're the one who gives life to all things. You are the meaning of life. You are the purpose for our existence. You are our all in all. We thank You, Lord, for these things. And it causes us to worship You. And those of us who know You do that. We respond to that by just lifting our hearts to You. But Father, if there are any in this place this morning that don't know You, or someone who's within the sound of my voice, that has never done business with You, has never come to this place of surrender, then I pray that You'd speak to their hearts, that by Your Holy Spirit, You would convict them of their sin, but at the same time, help them to recognize that there is a Savior who is ready to receive them if they will but confess and surrender. If that's you this morning, I want to just lead you in a short prayer, because there's nothing special about the prayer itself. It's just my giving you an opportunity to share what's on your heart with the Lord. Confession and a desire to be saved and the desire to walk with Him for the rest of your days till you see Him face to face and hear, well done. If that's you, just repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I realize now that I'm a sinner and that I'm hopelessly lost in my sin. But I thank You that Jesus died on the cross, God in the flesh, to take away my sins, that I might be free and forgiven. I believe He died for my sins. And I want to receive Him now as my Lord and my Savior. Help me to leave the old life behind. My sinful way of living, my way of thinking, my way of doing. And to surrender to Your skillful hand as You make me new. I want a new heart that beats for You. Thank You for Your grace. And thank You for being merciful to me, a sinner. I want to walk with You all my days. So give me the strength to do so. Thank You. I love You and I praise You. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, I would really invite you to stay afterwards so I could just talk to you and pray with you through your Bible and start to just help you learn what it means to walk with the Lord. The rest of you, I do pray that, that you have a great week as you walk with Him. Why don't you stand with us as we close with a song this morning? And if you need prayer, really for any reason afterwards, you can always stay. I'd love to pray with you. But the rest of you, I hope you enjoy a good time of fellowship. Just have a wonderful week in the Lord. Bless you.
Savior's love.
just thank you for your love for us, Lord, and for that day when we will be in your presence, singing your praises for all of eternity. Praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Have a great week.